everyone. My name is Roberto Velasco, and today we are going to talk about OWASP, some project about OWASP, how to create secure applications. Some notes about me. I am involved in software development and architecture since 2004, and in software security since 2001. One of my personal projects that after that has become an enterprise product, it's HDIF Security, that you have a community project and also an enterprise company behind that. And I am the founder of both, both projects. First of all, about OWASP. I don't know how many of you know about OWASP. Probably most of you. Okay, great. Almost everybody. Okay, great. As you know, it's a free and open source organization that offers tools and documentation. You have many resources. Today, we are going to review four projects from OWASP, at least an overview of each of specification, because we don't have time to review all of them in detail, but at least we will try to explain which is the difference between different specifications and what will be a good path to create secure applications. Let's start with OWASP Top 10 that probably you know about them. How many of you know about OWASP Top 10? Okay, great, almost everybody as well. Okay, great. So as you know, we have a new specification that was published 2 years ago. Basically, if you see in detail, it's not so different, okay? Actually, it's a bit surprising that in 4 years, we have almost the same issues, okay, in the top 10. We haven't improved too much. Actually, they have merged some of them, access control risk like A4 and A7 has been integrated in just one issue, but the problems are almost the same, exactly the same. They are exactly the same. And they have added new risks like XML external entities, insecure deserialization, and insufficient login and monitoring, okay? As you can see, they are not new. They are not actually new, okay? Maybe we have seen more frequently in the last years. That's why they are in the top 10, okay? But we are not talking about new things. And at the same time, the problems are there, right? So it means that the technology and the way that we are building applications maybe is not the best way, okay, to create applications, okay? Because in the end, we have similar issues. One additional comment about the OWASP Top 10 is that if you analyze which is the source of that information and that top 10, you will see that there are two sources of information. First of all, we have the vendors, the security vendors that generate information about the detected issues. And unfortunately, the issues that are reported by the vendors are the issues that can be detected by tools. Right? I mean, the most frequent issues reported by the vendors are the issues that they are able to detect, not the whole risk, okay? Do you understand that? That's very important. In addition, there are, of course, inputs from the community, but they are relevant, but the data that we have from a statistic mostly come from vendors because they have the input from the market. Let's see a couple of examples, very old examples of issues, but to have a reference about what we are talking about in the OWASP Top 10. SQL injection, or injection in general, is one of the most famous one. It was the first one in the previous OWASP Top 10. Now it continued to be the first one in the last Top 10. Basically, we are talking about bad practices in the programming of SQL queries or database access. Basically, we have two kinds of database access. The access that we are using the data that come from the request, and we are adding that to the SQL query, okay? That's the example, okay? In that case, you can change the meaning of the query, okay? You can change the meaning of the query, so for instance, instead of getting one order, you can get all the orders of a table. Okay, it's very easy to manipulate that. The solution, it's very simple. Basically, we have to use parameterized queries. In the case of Java, basically using prepared statement. So instead of getting the data and putting it in the SQL query directly, we use a parameter. Okay, we declare a parameter in the SQL query and we assign a value of that. Simple, right? It's easy. The thing is that if you have 2,000 access to the database, maybe you have 95% okay, or maybe 98, but 2% is enough to lose all your data, right? So one issue is enough to have a critical security issue regarding this risk. It's one of the most critical ones. The similar happened with when we are using HQL or ORMs. It's the same example. We have to use basically parameters in the queries, okay, to avoid that issue. A second example that it's very common as well, and I will say that I have chosen those two examples because one of them represents that we call security bugs. Basically, they are syntactic issues, okay, that using tools are detectable. But there is a second one of issues that, unfortunately, it's not possible to detect with tools, like access control issues. That way, I have chosen one of two typologies of issues. So regarding access control, in the previous OWASP of them, we had two risks, okay? And in the current one, we have only one risk, okay? It means that we have solved one of the problems. Not at all, okay, not at all. I think that they have merged the concept. The idea is the same, that's correct. I mean, we are talking about access control issues. Unfortunately, in the previous one, I think that it's relevant to split the two issues, okay? Because one of them, the A7, usually it's well implemented into the applications, okay? A7 is when you access directly to a URL, for instance, imagine /admin, okay? When you try to access to an admin URL. And insecure direct of the reference is when you are trying to read, for instance, a row in a table. Imagine that you have access to a table, you have access to read data in that table, but only to some specific orders, okay? So A4, it's very common in many applications. It's very common. And in our experience, auditing applications and looking at how developers create applications, we see that basic authentication and basic access control based in roles, usually it's okay. Okay, or at least it's something that people do, right? But if we go to a low level access control, things are different, okay? Totally different. In many cases, because it's not so easy to implement, okay? If you have a complex database with different tables, it's not so easy to implement. Let's see an example, okay? The first example, it's a very basic attack where you have, in that case, a REST API. Imagine that you have a REST API, you have an ID, and basically the programmer use that ID in the query, okay? And don't include any other condition to the query, okay? So if somebody changed that number, okay, change the ID, we are able to change the meaning of the query and get the data from another order that is not an order from that user, okay? That's a very common mistake that, unfortunately, as well, is not possible to detect with tools, right? That's an additional problem. I mean, problems that are detectable with tools are easier to handle. Problems that are not detectable are complex to handle because we need people for that, right? So a good example is when we have the same condition and at the same time we verify that the owner of that row is the authenticated user, okay? Adding that condition, if somebody changed the ID, the result set will be empty, right? Because the condition of the owner will not fit, okay? It doesn't work, okay? So you are safe. The problem, in that case, it's possible to do it because maybe we have one table. When we have many tables and we have a complex database, it's more complicated. And in some cases, the resulting query is too complex, too heavy, okay? So I have seen many cases where the developer or the company say, oh, it's too expensive to do to make that these kind of joins. Okay, so it's not so easy to do it, and in many cases it requires a custom solution for each specific case. Okay, so it's not it's an easy example, this one, but to fix that issue in a complex application, it's not so easy to handle it properly. In summary, even though we don't have time to review the whole OWASP top 10, some ideas about the OWASP top 10. The first idea is not a complete list of issues. Okay? It's a top 10. It's a top 10. So if you are reviewing the OWASP top 10, or maybe in your organization, or somebody told you you have to check the top 10, okay, it's okay, you have to check the top 10, but it's not enough. Probably the people that told you that, probably he's or she is not looking for partially secure applications. They probably need totally secure applications. So that's the first idea. As I mentioned previously, be careful with that. The top 10 is created mainly from the input of the vendors. So they focused in some specific issues, okay? Actually, using appropriate tools, you are going to fix almost all the top 10, okay? But that's the easy part, right? The difficult part is the rest of the issues. And that's why I comment that, okay? So that's regarding the OWASP top 10, and the message is be careful with that, it's not enough. And we will see later that there is a new standard provided by OWASP that fixed that issue, okay? There is an additional specification or document from OWASP that is called OWASP Proactive Control. In that case, we are not talking about risk. We are talking about the solution or the best practice that programmers should implement. Okay, so it's a totally different top 10, even though it's a top 10. Okay, we have different aspects like database access, access control, and so on. Okay. Let's see some examples directly from the documentation of the specification. Okay, for instance, in the secure database access, they talk about parameterized queries, prepared statement, and so on. Okay, query parametrization is the solution. It's the similar idea. In the case of access control, the same. They give you the advice to check the access control and at low row level and high level. Okay, it's very similar to the recommendation that we can see in the OWASP top 10. Okay, the problem with a proactive control is very similar comparing with the OWASP top 10. It's not complete. Okay, it's not complete. It's the top 10 of the most important security features that we should take into account. But it's not enough, okay? It's not enough. And we recommend to use another standard that we are going to explain now, okay? The third specification of today from OWASP is OWASP Application Security Verification Standard, or ASVS. How many of you know about it? Great, okay. Two people, okay? The summary is that most of you know about OWASP top 10, only two of you know about OWASP ASVS, okay? That's important, that's why we are talking about it. In the case of OWASP Application Security Verification Standard, we have 14 aspects that they talk about, and it's very detailed Git. I mean, they are covering all the issues, okay? So if you want to implement within your organization, so maybe you are subcontracting some company, if you want to have a reference about how to create a secure application, you should use this Git, okay? You are talking about 60, 70 pages, okay? Not one page, right? So I think that's the first message. Please use OWASP ASVS as reference, okay? An overview of that specification. Because it's a very complete specification, they have three different levels or maturity levels. Okay, you can start with the first one, with the level one, that is the entry level, and the verification of this entry level it's done using it's enough testing the application from outside. Okay, imagine that you subcontract a security consultancy company to test the application from outside your system, okay? Using manual work or tools like Dust or web scanners. Maybe you know about web scanners. Dust are web scanners. And there is a new approach that also make possible to audit an application external. It's IAST. It's a different approach for detecting security bugs. But basically, we are talking about a black box testing methodology. It means that in that case, they don't see the source code, and they don't talk with the developers. Okay, it's like an entry point to the specification. So if you are not doing anything, that will be a good starting point. Okay. If you are managing applications that contain sensitive data, or maybe they are critical, we have to move to another levels. In that case, the testing methodology is based on black box, as we have in level one. I mean, we are still doing the external penetration testing, but it's mandatory to see the source code, to analyze the source code, talk with developers, and so on. Okay, so you have full access. The auditing process has full access to the developing process. Okay, in that case, it's common to use a source code analyzer or IAST as well that give you access to issues in the source code. I don't know how many of you is using detection solutions like SAST or DAST. Okay, two people. Okay, I think. We will see later which is the last advice, but it's highly recommended to use these kind of tools because as we mentioned that there are two kind of issues. One of them is covered by those tools. And the last one, the level three, it has been designed for critical applications like applications that manage high value transactions, basically money, medical data, military applications, and so on, okay? In that case, it's similar the way that we test the applications. We use black box and white box. Okay, and also tools like SAST and IAST. Let's see some examples of that specification. We will see the same examples that we have seen in the last example, but in that case in ASVS. If we check how we have to manage database access, they talk as well about that we have to use parametrized queries, okay? And if we are using HQL or ORM, it's a similar advice, okay? They have in that section more recommendations for other things, but regarding database access, that's the recommendation. You can see here as well. Within each point of the specification, they told us if it's a requirement for level one, level two, or level three. Okay, in that case, parameterized queries it's mandatory for all the levels. Okay, so we are not talking about a sophisticated feature; we are talking about basic things that everybody has to implement. Okay. Let's see the other example of access control. In that case, it's very similar. They told that. We have to verify the access to resources against direct of your reference and so on, okay? In that case as well, it's mandatory for all the levels, okay? And they add as well a reference to cross-site request forgery in the access control part, okay? Cross-site request forgery, maybe you know that in the previous OWASP top 10, it was included, and now they have removed from the specification, okay? But basically, as I said, they told you for each requirement, for each maturity level, which are the requirements that you have to implement. Okay, the summary of application security verification standard. Unlike the previous specification, in that case, it's a complete specification. That's a huge difference. Okay, we are not talking about 10 issues. We are talking about all the possible issues and how to solve them. Okay, so that's very important. It starts gradually. If you are not implementing an application security program, we highly recommend using first level one, after level two, and after level three, okay? Because it's not easy to move from anything to level three, okay? It's expensive for organizations that don't have an infrastructure for that, okay? And finally, I will say that OWASP ASVS is a good reference, it's a good document to have an internal specification of application security, but probably you have specific needs that are not covered by the specification, okay? So you can fork the documentation and create a new one to cover custom needs. And even better, if you have new ideas, you can contribute to the community, right? It's an open community. You can perform a pull request or send a suggestion to improve the specification, okay? Actually, they are looking for feedback from the community about how it works and if it's a good solution or not, okay? So feel free to do it as well, okay? So that's the most important differences, and we highly recommend using it. Lastly, a reference of other OWASP project that is called OWASP Benchmark. OWASP Benchmark, it's a project, it's a tool to evaluate how good it's a detection solution, okay? We mentioned previously that there are three detection approaches, DAST, Dynamic Application Security Testing, web scanners, SAST, source code analyzers, and IaaS, that it's an hybrid approach that has access to the compile code and also get the dynamic view of the applications. And basically, OWASP Benchmark give us a number to evaluate the accuracy level of those tools. Okay, it will be great if we will have a tool for that for everything, because they give you a number, okay, to evaluate how good it is. So basically, they measure if the tools are able to detect all the security issues and if they don't generate false positives, okay? One of the main issues in security are false positives. If you are looking to a firewall or a WAF or something like that, probably you will see that there are gigabytes of information that you have to review, right? So regarding this kind of tools, it's important to avoid as well false positives, okay? So if you start implementing an ASVS and you start using this kind of tools, it's a good advice to use OWASP Benchmark to evaluate it. Okay, it's a test that you run and you get a number and it's free. Okay, till now we have talked about documents. Okay, about 60, 70 pages of documentation. It sounds good. You read the document, it sounds good, but after that you have to apply, right? It's not easy. If you have people working for you, probably you are busy doing business for your company, and security usually is the last step, right? It's not, you don't have, or we don't have enough time in many cases to apply security, okay? So the thing is how to handle that, how implement this kind of specifications for human beings, okay? Because we are human beings that we don't have enough time to do all the tasks manually, okay? I think that the idea or the key question is the automation and design, okay? Application security is a very complex problem. It's not a simple problem. We are not talking about one specific issue. We are talking many issues that we have to handle manually. One analogy that I love to compare with application security is air traffic control, okay? Imagine an airport in London or New York, and you have to handle thousands of planes or flights at the same time, okay? Do you think that it's possible to handle that manually? It's almost impossible, okay? It's too complex to handle it manually. Application security is very similar, it's complex. If you have to handle manually all the requirements, it's a nightmare. It's impossible to do it properly, okay? And one or two issues are enough to break your security, okay? So I think one important aspect of application security is think that it's very difficult to do it manually at least 100%, okay? So let's move to how to automate and how to design secure applications. First of all, within the OWASP ASVS, they talk about tools, okay? They talk about automation, okay? In that case, they limit their advice to detection solutions like DAST and SAST. Okay, I will say that IAST is a good approach as well, because they give us the same result. So they are recommending to use tools for that, okay? Because it's not easy to handle manually, okay? The second point about tools within the ASVS, they give us a feedback. They told us that some of the issues, some of the typology of the issues, like business logic flows and access control, are only the testing of these issues is only possible using human assistance, okay? I mean, it's not possible to use a web scanner or a SAST or an IAST and detect an access control issue. It's impossible, okay? It's impossible because we are not talking about a syntax issue. We are talking about a domain issue, a business-related issue, right? So they are telling us that some of the risk can be covered or detected with tools, and others are not covered by this kind of tools, okay? So basically, it's implemented manually, okay? That's the summary that I really like to talk about, okay? Because if we talk about top 10, or if we talk about OWASP ASVS, you will see many, many issues, okay? But I think that two families are a good idea to understand how it works. Many of the security issues are basically security bugs, bugs related with the syntax of our code, okay? It's like when we are writing a text and the word processors tell us that we have made a mistake, right? And the processor is telling us that, oh, maybe you have an issue here, okay? It's very similar. Unfortunately, we can cover an important part, a significant part of the issues using tools, right? But unfortunately, there is other 50%, about 50% of the total problems that they are not into that category, okay? They are called business logic flows, design flows, they have different names, but basically we are talking about two different problems. One of them could be easily automated, and the second one is not so easy, okay? It's not so easy to automate. And actually, in the organizations that I see that they are more mature, usually they have almost solved those issues. Using tools, using continuous reviewing, they have almost solved that, okay? Mature organizations using appropriate tools, they have almost solved that. And they are worried about this part, okay? One comment from one of the most important security experts in the world, that is Gary McGraw. He's the intellectual founder of Fortify, that is one of the most well-known detection solutions, and he's a very relevant security consultant. And I love that phrase from Gary. He talks about that software security is about integrating security practice into the way you build software and not integrating security features into your code, okay? It means that it's not enough if we build or we develop the applications in any sense without any design, and after that we will try to solve it or fix it. It's very difficult, okay? I will give you an example of that we are seeing currently many times. You know that nowadays, probably many of you are using client-side MVC applications, okay? With JavaScript and so on. So the logic of the application is moving significantly to the client-side, also with mobile applications. So we are seeing many people doing access control inside the JavaScript, for instance, okay? That's a typical mistake. They are adding security logic in the JavaScript. And as you know, you can bypass, you can remove everything in the client side, so you can do whatever you want. So it doesn't work in practice, okay? It's not easy to fix an application that has used that process, okay? That's why we say it's important, the design. Let's see now, what's the proposal from our side about how to develop a secure application. First of all, use the OWASP ASVS. I think it's a good reference to have an application security program. Use tools. Use good tools that cover 100% of OWASP benchmark. It's easy to measure. run the test and see how good is the tool. And the third point, and that's, I think that's the newest one and the most difficult one to implement, is perform an architecture review and integrate protection solutions into the application. Okay, automate some of the protection measures that are necessary into the applications. Okay, many of the security tasks are very related with input validation, and input validation can be automated using some ideas that we are going to show now, but it's possible to automate a significant part of the validation. Okay, and lastly, pen testing. The last step is pen testing. Please don't start with the pen testing. If you are not using tools and if you don't do architecture review, probably you have a vulnerable application. That's the most common case. Okay, so start with the pen testing. I think it's the best idea. Regarding the detection tools, the second point, I will recommend to use it during the whole software development lifecycle, not only in production or not only in development. I think it's a good idea to use in all stages. Use accurate solutions that cover OWASP benchmark 100%. I mean, detect everything and don't generate any false positive. And important as well, analyze the third-party software. I have seen many customers using detection solutions only in their source code. Okay? Probably they are testing only about 10% of their code, because actually we are using many dependencies. Okay? And in the end, the dependencies that contains vulnerabilities are our vulnerabilities, right? So it's necessary to have a software that check it. Okay? There are two ways to check it. One of them is with CVE. There are common vulnerabilities published on the internet. Okay? And if you know the version of the library that you are using, you can check. Do you know about CVE? Okay. That's a very well-known reference, but there is other kind of issues that are interesting as well. Imagine a third-party library that has a vulnerability that has not been published yet, right? And probably you don't have the source code because you are using the binary. What's the solution, okay? For instance, with the IAST approach that I mentioned before, it's possible to review the binaries. You are reviewing actually the binaries, right? So you are able to detect even zero-day vulnerabilities in your dependencies. Maybe they are not published yet, but you are able to detect them, okay? So that's important. Okay, let's see a demo about a detection solution. In that case, we are going to use our AIA solution, HDIF detection AIA solution. That's the approach that I mentioned before. It works with an agent. Maybe you are using monitoring solutions like AppDynamics, New Relic, or so on. It's very similar architecture. You put an agent in your application, okay? You install it, restart the server, and that's it, okay? And you run the application, that's it. So you can apply even in production, okay? Once we have the agent running, we go to the application, and in that case, we have a view for the developer. That's a developer toolbar here in the bottom of the screen. And while we are browsing the application, the tool is telling us the vulnerabilities that the tool is detecting, okay? We go into the application, and for instance, in that case, the tool is showing different SQL injection vulnerabilities, getting us the dynamic view, the URL and the parameter, and also the dynamic, the static view, the file and the line, okay? Even we can move to the code, okay? We can go, in that case, to Eclipse, and see the vulnerability in the code, okay? So, as I mentioned before, using a tool, these kind of vulnerabilities can be solved very easily, okay? In addition to the development phase, you can use as well these kind of tools during the continuous integration or continuous deployment, okay? You can define different policies. For instance, in that example, we will define a policy where if you have more than two SQL injection vulnerabilities, we are going to stop the build, okay? You can put, if you have any high, you can stop, okay? But that's the example. So we generate the build, and it doesn't work, okay? It means that from the security perspective, the build is not good enough, okay? And we block the path to production, right? I mean, we are automating the policies, the security policies in our versions. So now, if we fix the issue, the build is accepted, and we have less than 3, and we are able to generate a new version that can go to production, okay? So that's the example of automation during the development and during the continuous integration or continuous deployment, okay? Okay, regarding protection, as we said, that part is not so common, okay? As we said, using tools, we can fix some of the issues, but other issues are not solved, okay? Like business logic flows, access control issues, okay? And basically, we have to perform input validation manually. That's the solution, okay? In our case, in HDF, we are working many years ago about that problem and how to automate that. One of the solutions that we are using is a concept that we call contract enforcement, okay? Basically, it's a very basic theory. Basically, we explain that saying that what you see is what you get, okay? For instance, in the applications, when we are sending a link or a JSON data or an ID or a reference to the customer, basically, we are exposing a resource. We are exposing a possible interaction, okay? If we are able to understand what we are exposing to the customers and we are able to enforce that contract, okay, through the architecture, we can avoid many of those issues, okay? And we are doing that integrating our technology in technologies like web frameworks, API libraries, and so on, okay? Let's see an example. The example of access control. That's a good example of access control, okay? We add a new condition to the SQL query, and we are safe from an access control attack, okay? The problem is that we don't have tools to review that. I mean, we have to check manually if our application is safe of those issues. And in addition to that, it depends on people, okay? Maybe some people do that, maybe others don't do that, right? How to handle that manually, or how we can fix that? One different approach is try to automate the interaction or validate the interaction. If we are able to control the URLs that we send to the customers or the IDs of the REST APIs that we are exposing, we can control the integrity of the URL that we are exposing, okay? In that case, this URL. If we are able to apply integrity and verify that the URL or the resource is the same that we have sent previously, we are safe, okay? So we are safe from access control issues, and also from other issues. Imagine that the hacker, in addition to change the number, add an additional parameter, okay? Do you know binding attack of massive assignment attacks? Do you know it? Basically, it's when you add additional parameters to a URL, okay? These kind of attacks are not possible to handle with that. That's access control, but massive attack, it's another issue, right? So if we focus our attention to the interaction with the customers, and we are able to automate the enforcement of that contract, we can avoid many of those issues, okay? In our case, we are implementing it with extension of different technologies. Basically, we are using hooking instrumentation techniques. And with that extensions, we are getting information about the data that we are exposing into the customers, okay? And we have afterwards a filter that validates if the data it's okay or they have changed that contract, okay? Let's see And we have, important, we have a version of HDF, a community version of HDF that it's integrated as well in Spring, okay? So let's see an example about how it works in practice, okay? So first of all, the installation of the solution that works into the architecture, okay? We are not talking something that was in one line of the code, okay? We are talking about something that is integrated in the architecture like you do with Spring Security. It's a very similar idea, okay? So we go to the Maven dependency file, and we add the dependency of HDF in that case, okay? We add the dependency. We define as well the listener and so on, and we restart the application, okay? So basically, it's a declarative installation. After that, we move to the application, that's the web console to control the protection solution, and we will put it running, okay? We put it running, and we are going to perform some basic attacks that we mentioned previously. First of all, we are going to change the value of a parameters in a URL, okay? Very basic attack, an access control attack. If we change it, it doesn't work, okay? That's the architecture, okay? That's the architecture who is validating that, not manual validation, okay? The same happened with other kind of components, like, that's the information about the attack. We are logging as well the attack. We have the URL, we have the username, and so on. So we can monitor as well the activity. That's important for security. We are monitoring the malicious activity, okay? If we do the same with another example, a combo box, it's a very similar attack. We change the select, we change the value. Okay. And we are able to, basically we are changing the contract offered by the application, and we are able to detect the attack. Okay. Let's see another example of access control. That's the past A7. And when someone go to an admin URL, we are able to block it, okay? Let's see another different attack that is not possible to stop with access control verification, that is binding attack or massive assignment attack, okay? In that case, we are going to add an additional parameter to the form that basically is the fee of the transaction, okay? That additional parameter is not expected by the server side, and we are going to add that fee. Okay, that it's zero, okay? To avoid the fee, okay? And the server has detected that we have added an additional parameter to the interaction, okay? So, as I said, with a contract enforcement approach, it's possible to stop, actually, this kind of business logic or access control attacks, okay? That are not possible to handle with tools, okay? A summary of the talk, we have mentioned many times, but use OWASP ASVS as reference, okay? OWASP Top 10 is not enough, that's the message. I know that you know about OWASP Top 10, but I hope that after that talk, you will read at least the OWASP ASVS. Please let me know if you like it or not. The second advice is automation, use tools, use detection tools, and if you are able as well, use protection tools as well, okay? Because even though we highly recommend using best practices and teach your developers and so on, it's very difficult to do it properly. One issue is enough. One problem is enough to break your security, okay? So it's remember the air traffic control system. It's very difficult to do it manually properly, okay? And finally, finish your security process with pen testing. Okay, don't start from the pen testing, and finish the process with that. And if you are able to do with an external entity and third party entity, it's better, okay? Because you have an independent opinion. Okay. So that's it.